to prioritize grooves for live performing? That is today's video. Let's go do that right now. Hey, what's up, I'm Analog Kitchen, and thank you for checking out yet another video. If this is your first time here, don't hesitate to click subscribe, hit that notification bell, because you'll be updated whenever I upload a new video. You'll be kept in the loop. You won't miss out on anything. If you like the sounds, the drums, the sample and whole kind of stuff that you're hearing in my videos, you can actually acquire that Analog Kitchen sound yourself. I will leave a link up on the page here, and that is where you can buy the sample packs that I have. There's three online now. There is the percussive helpers, that's the biggest one. There's over 3,000 sounds in there, really. I've processed them, I've EQ'd them, I've selected them after my years of being in the industry. There's a big collection of samples that I have, so I've made it for it to be like that cogwheel that you might miss if you just got your different samples stuck together. So if there's a bass, a synthesizer, and then there's a drum computer, and then there's a synthesizer, it is spaced out, and you might need a little bit of grit to just get those bricks to sit together well. That is that pack. And then there's the FX and drones pack as well. So if you want to just go like all assimilated by the Borg, get that pack as well. I will leave a link up there. So thanks for the support. Be sure to hang out to the end of this video. I will tell you what I'm doing on patreon.com/analogkitchen, where I'm doing a few projects. I will divulge everything towards the end of this video, so stay tuned for that. Links to the equipment is noted in the fold below. If you see the page and it says show more, just hover over there and click on it. It will open and you'll see affiliate links to all the gear that I am using. If there's anything you would still like to know, don't be a stranger and leave a comment in the comment section below as well. It's all about creating a community for me, which is really, really what I like. It's cool. So I have got Patreon connected to Discord, which means there's a cool community of like-minded synthesizer folks that are actually talking about all this nerdy synth stuff. So if you'd like to care to join, hover over there and just find out what the Discord is all about. So stay tuned to the end of the video. I will tell you how you can enlist and get on there, as well as channel memberships. This is a new thing that YouTube is doing. You can actually just, like, instead of joining up on Patreon, you can also just join up here on the YouTube channel, which is a cool thing to do. There's four different tiers that I have set up. It's basically getting in touch, getting specials, getting discounts on merch and deals. And the highest tier is actually where you can film yourself asking me a question, and I will edit it into this video, and then we'll just look at the question you might have. I think it's always better to have answers instead of questions. If you have got more questions than answers, not a good thing. Be sure to get in touch, check out the channel memberships, and I'll leave a link also in the description below. Now, the setting for today's video actually came from some of my subscribers, from my loyal patrons, which follow me on patreon.com/analogkitchen, and they've asked me, can you do a video on the in-between parts? Can you just, like, get into, I mean, we know the grooves and we know, like, what it is that you're doing, but can you tell us about what is the in-between stuff that you're sticking in your beat to make your beat interesting? Because we're struggling with that. So it was Atlantis and it was Carson that actually came up with that. Great topic, you guys. So I thought to do just something about not only the in-between stuff, but why not just go straight in and dive into how to prioritize what it is that you want to do. Now, if you follow this channel, you know me talking about a trilogy of priorities. Yeah, there's an A category, there's a B category, and there's a C category.
Everybody learn your ABCs.
Which means the A category, if you're looking at, here it comes. If you're looking at building a house, for instance, I mean, the objective should be that the house should never ever collapse. Yeah, if you're building a track. So the first thing I would look for is the foundation and everything that holds the house up. There's no interior design, there's no nothing there that can make the house stand out from other houses, but still, that's the thing that I'm looking for. So what can you imagine would that be? I would suggest you look at bass drum, bass line, something that's really the foundation of your track, and that will stand out. You should dance to that forever. It should not bore you. That thing on its own should be cool. Then The second thing you would do is to go for the B segment. That's like adding some more stuff to your house, like doors and windows, something to make it, your house a little bit more comfortable. So in that case, it's like top loops, grooves. It's more of like ear candy here and there. And then the third priority, which is the C category, is where you would actually stick a little bit of like your own sort of flavor in there. It really is there to just make your track stand out from all the other tracks. But if it wasn't there, you would not lose any sleep over it. So it's really like the small effects here and there. Now, I always say that a groove is made up of not the notes that are being played, but what's in between the notes. I mean, the space between the notes is what makes up the groove. So it's not what you play, it's the lack of what's there. That's what's making up the groove. When you look at a TR-909 drum computer, the timing is off. I mean, not completely off, obviously, it's danceable, but when you would record a 909 drum computer for days on end on a DAW or in your computer, and you will line up the kicks to the grid, you will see that there's no kick that's always 100% going to be straight on the grid, and that gives it that groove. So the shifting and the, you know, that's doing it by itself. Really cool. But in a DAWless environment where you now need to just like make up where the groove is, you can't do that with all different kinds of equipment. You know what I mean? If you are savvy and you are really listening to your gear, you will pick up after a while where the groove and where the sweet spot of certain grooves, certain machines are. But then again, if you use something like a multi-clock or something else, you'll see that it determines the groove. It sets everything straight. So it can invoke a little bit of liveliness. Now, how to stick those in-between things in your music, that's what we're going to get into today. So how to prioritize your grooves? What do you stick where when you perform live? Let's go over to the live set and let's see if we can make it work. Are you ready? Let's go. All right, guys. Stop it here. Today, the setup is quite different. Not quite different, but I've opted to go with something that's a little bit more easy to explain for me, as today the Tempest is making an appearance. Now, I have got a pattern set up. The kick is over here, I think, which plays this. This is a kick that I've made myself. There's another one. Not playing because I think it's in the mute modes. Go here, yeah, there you go. So stop it here. So stop. So this is a nice 808 type kick. So obviously to build up your track, you start with the foundation. Now I was talking about the three categories that I just space my track into. So this is obviously my kick. I'll go to the mute mode. So this kick's playing right here. Let's play it here. Go in, 60 mutes. The kicks are playing. Now, you can just go in and play a hi-hat, which just spaces out the complete stereo spectrum. But what I will do is I have a shaker that I've played velocity sensitively, so it will go, it will play like that. Now keep this in mind. This is how I really start the track, because I want to get a ballpark figure in my head where the kick sits and where the hats or the high frequencies are sitting. There's another thing that I'm going to put in between, but that's later on. I've got my Akai MPC Live and the Octatrack gel together. I've got a sample and hold sample out of the sample pack that is going to come in later. I've got the Model B, I've got the Mini Tower, I've got the Micro Monster, I've got the Daysmith right here, and then I've got the TB-03 over here. But let's focus on the drums first. Now, this is nice. This is the babadabababadikadikadik. This is already something that I think, like, if I add a 303 line in there, let's see. Instantly, we're moving, yeah? If I go into a different bank and I'll play something else, something hacerlo. Adiós. I'm not 100% sure that it's aligned correctly. There you go. You can do with a little bit of lag. Shuffle it. So the kick is doing what it's doing, and those shakers are doing what they're doing. So you, I immediately try and see if this is something that I can get into. Yes. Now, I've got another kick that I would like to, let's mute this first. I've got another kick that I have that plays something together with this kick as a catalyst already. So what I will do is I'll go in and play it. It's on Aether. I'm on 129 BPM today. Nice. Now this is something that I will classify as a just 360 degree pattern. This can be my drop, this can be everything. This in a club should make you dance instantly without you asking for more information really. So today I'm not really going to shape sounds and do crazy stuff. I just wanted to just like go like, what are the in-between parts that I'm using? Now, obviously for the obvious part, which is the kick, I do think that, you know, this is already driving the beat. And with my hat, or shaker that acts as a hat here. So you get like a cadence of different things that are grooving. Now this means that it's already filling up the spot where stuff needs to go. So if I want to place other things, I need to be very careful with what it is that I'm going to place where. What I'm lacking here is an open hat. Now the open hat is going to come from the Akai MPC Live, which is on the multi-clock on channel 3, because the Tempest is on 4 and the TB 03 is on 2. So here is. So I've got more toms coming. Now let's lower the toms that I've got here. Because I've got toms coming also from. Now let's take out the Tempest. Pretty much this is a straightforward 808 hat that sits there, but it sits in a certain level as you can hear. It doesn't really overpower everything, it's just there. I've got that mapped out on the Launch Control XL, which you can see in the bottom right corner. And I've mapped the sounds out so that they're actually on, everything is here. Yeah, so the toms are here. Toms on 8, so of course I can map up more drums and more different things, but in my mind I'm like, what is important to me? Is this important if I already got like a kick on the Tempest playing similar stuff? It's like I'm throwing a lot of pots and pans down the stairs. It's cool, but it's taking a lot away from the spectrum. And in that frequency range where this kick is sitting, this one, and as you can hear, I deliberately played around with the velocities. Now, if you're doing stuff away from everything that's obvious on a dance track, which means something that needs to go away a little bit more from where the kick sits, velocities and the way they act make your pattern longer, or at least give a sense that there's more happening. So if you're listening to what's happening here, you hear boop, pa, 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 ooh, ooh, pa, 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 pa. So you can hear that I've played around with velocities over a 2-bar spaced out period. So listen to it. Which is nice. So there's a little bit more of a T attack and a D attack, and they both play together. So with the kick. Nice. Now, close that. Now certain things need to have velocity and others just need to just like be a lot of in your face. I think that a tom doesn't need to be that frequency, is just constantly punching the speaker in your gut. So you don't want stuff to be too sparse, too rigid, too in your face over there. So but the 808 hats, they need to be sitting where where they're sitting, because this is the thing that's very hypnotizing. Now what I try to do is I lower the volume, because now I'm not mixing anything, but I'm just leveling stuff out. So usually I will go in and that's a very good idea. Let's go find the track. Out of my mind, it's the close head over here. I will go to the pad mixer. See, there's the bonus minus 11 dB already, so I will turn it down. Obviously, in the grand scheme of things, this thing is coming out on the mixer. The Octatrack is coming out on the mixer, so that's where you do your stem leveling. But all the sounds together need to just also play together in a nice fashion. Now, this works, yeah? What else we have? We've got the open hat. Now the open hat is something that if you are working it in your music early on, it takes a lot of energy out of your focus point. So I will lower it because the impact is cool, but for the first hour, and then you get used to it and then it doesn't really do that magical trick anymore. So I will still like to surprise myself working with my music. So what I need to do is not drain the energy away from my focus point, as there's more stuff that we want to add to this groove. Now, let's go in. Head. And because it's a cadence, now, I don't know if you notice it, but that 808 kick that we had right here is a very important driving force now, because this is just straightforward. Four to the floor kind of a vibe, but this giving me a dancing cadence. If you know my videos, you know I like to dance when I'm working. Okay, that's that. Let's go and see if we can find a sample and hold catalyst, because that's the next step. What I want to do, gel all those drums together. So we'll be right back. got my techno groove going. Now, you can clearly hear that I've got like the A category, which is my beat, boom, 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 and my B is the sample and hold over here. Now, what I will do, usually, let's stop it for a second. Nice. Let's see if we can get a few of those effects to go in there. I have got more samples. Let's see, where's my effects? I'll cut this out so you don't have to wait for me for like forever, from the first time in forever. All right. Vocal, there's a crash over here, which is not playing. Am I playing? Right. I'll go in and go vocal. There's no vocal playing. So I will go into that page here. Go into the vocal bit. I'll just be nice and tidy. And what I'll do is I'll say vocal. No, I'll go into F. X. Yeah. Now I will go in, I'll say assign samples. So I'll go to the sample bank. I see that this is pretty filled up, so I'll go to another bank that's almost filled up. I see that I've got some free spaces over here. I'll go to browse, and then I'll go to places. And then I'll go to the USB disk where I got the sample and hold, the percussive helpers, and what I want is see Dawless weapons. What have I got? Yeah. No, I need to go in, sample and hold, that's the one. And then we've got here. Yes, nice one. Okay, and what I want is acoustic drums and effects. What have I got? I forgot cymbals. Yeah, splash cymbals maybe. I'm liking this because it's got the high frequency, but we're going to do something with it that it's not that bright. So I'm going to load it in, which means that it's playing. Is it playing over here? No, obviously not. Assign samples. Yes, it's here. Yes, but I think. Okay. Yep. Already mapped out. Now what I'll do is go out, and I'll go to the edit samples page, and I will tune it down. Very loud, so I'll go here and I'll go to the pad mixer. Now let's play what we have. I'll lower it to a point that I barely hear it, but it's still there. Boom, one, two, three, boom, one. Okay, I'll go out. It's on four beats, that's cool. So the whole pattern, which is playing eight bars. I'm not gonna play for eight bars, I'm only going to play it for one, two, three, four bars. Here we go. One, two, three. Mm. Now it plays, see? Lights up. There you go. Now this is an accent at the end of the bar that one, two, three, and boom. It tells you to start dancing back on the first of the bar. So there's a few groove tricks that are happening at the moment. As you can hear with the sample and hold bit that we have. Let's take everything out. So the first of the bar is fast, and the second part of the bar is slower. So 1 2 3 4 1 2, which means that you get catapulted into the groove, so the groove keeps running, which is a trick that you can do. Now this sample is doing it, but that's what I'm looking for. You get catapulted into the groove that's already running, but that crash that we just played and lowered is telling you that that sequence is going to start again. Listen. And hey, 2 3 and hey, boom, boom, and so now this is how you create an infinite loop. These tricks with placing sounds and lowering sounds and filtering them and not making them too loud, so sticking them a little bit too further away in the background, those are the tricks you really need in order to get those in-between bits to help your groove. If I'm not lying, and I think that I'm not, this should work. So what I'm going to do is do a trick as well. Now I have to entering my head, the closed and the open head on the Akai, which are coming from the launch control, and the Tempest are all starting together. So I'm looking at what's going on. This is how you build a drop. So now there's three things I need to do. I need to close this, enter in this, and open the head as well. 2, 3, 4, close, here we go. So, quick and savvy fingers. Cool. Can we add a little bit more music now? Because this is a part that's very important. That CBO3. See if we can do something here. What have we got? I'll go into bank B, bank A, bank B, and I'll go into 9, 10, 11, 12, maybe here. What's this? Certain frequency that it doesn't bother me. Yeah, nice. Okay. Bap, 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 bap. Nice. I've worked out a few drums. Boo-doo. Another thing that's not really taking eating away from your brain, but it's doing what it needs to do. Boo. Boo-doo. Listen. Funny, and it's played together with that ride that we just played. Kick in. Out, sample and all in. Here we go. Put it. Nice. Okay, so far, so good. Yeah. So now I've got this one sound that is playing on my effects page here. Is it here? No, it's here. What else can we stick in there? Assign samples. Let's look for more samples. We're going to stick something next to it. Same thing. Browse. I'm still here. Go out of this and see if we got another sound bank. So I will go in and where am I? This drum machine, single shots. No, don't want to go for the drums. I want to go for the Dawless Weapons Volume 1. No, let's go. Percussive Helpers. Ooh, now this. Lo-fi. Acoustic. No. Lo-fi drums. Let's go. Yeah, something like this, because we have got a lot of low-end content, we don't have a lot of high-end frequency content, so I think that we can do something with this, that's sitting over here, then we can go here. Maybe that as well, yeah? So, just random sounds that you can utilize to do different things. So I'll go out of this page, which means go main. So it's all in this on the effects track, yeah? Now first I'm going to play what I had, which is this. I'm not going to play it everywhere, just going to see if I can stick it in a certain spot. Like here, 1, 2, ah. Ah, yeah, this is a problem, so this is not what I want. All right, let's undo this, have to go out, and now I'll do it like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Because I'm going to play more samples, I need to play multiple things. Otherwise, I could have just used the small portion of the sequence, but that's not going to work now. So I'm going to play everything myself, so it's in there now. So let's go in, so yeah, you can see it. You can see that those are the notes that I've just played. Let's do that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And to the end of the bar, I'm going to play this one. So you see that there's another one there, bro. Two. Same at this spot. Three, four, five, six. Nice. Go out. Stick something on the one. Two, three, four, five, six, seven. Nice. Now we got some sort of pattern with the beat. As you can hear, let's turn off this sample and whole thing. Listen to these effects that I've just added. Kick out, DB03 in. It's a trick because I've learned this when working for radio. What you want to do is extend the listener's attention. That's what everything that we did when I was working in radio was that. And I think that same thing can apply to working in a rigorous environment that this live set is. Because obviously with loops, especially on my Octatrack now, I've only got the one bar running in a circle. So if you've got multiple things running in circles, it means that's not going to help you in the end. If you're going to do a 2, 3, 4 maybe longer set, you need stuff to come in randomly. And of course you can do it with trick conditions on the Octatrack, and you can just space stuff out. I like to have control in a certain way. So what I do is, instead of just having trick conditions and maybe it plays, maybe it doesn't play, oh does it play, yes, yes, no, I'll just play it, I use the Akai for one simple reason. This thing can play the longest of sequences. So my loop can be either one bar long, but it can be 32 bars as long if I want it to be that long. It says here, how many bars would you like it to be? Where would you like it to loop? It's just amazing, which is a cool feature because the Octatrack pretty much plays 4 bars or 64 kind of trigs. And you can get it to play longer, but that means you have to just stick this machine half tempo, which means if you played anything on MIDI, that now is going to come twice and twice as slow. And that's not what I want to aim for. So what I want is to have control over where stuff goes. And big cheat here, if I made something on my computer and I need to play it or replay it or play it live, obviously I'm not going to just like get 15 machines with white noise and drum rolls and the stuff that I might stick on my records that are releasing. So what I'm going to do is I'll sample the whole drop and I'll stick the drop in my MPC and add stuff on top of it, which is basically how, if you see Kink playing his tracks, some things are live and other things are sequenced, and that's why I loved working with that. Now let's see what we have so far. Now of course I will go in and see how those pads are working, because at the moment they're pretty loud. We don't like loud. Okay, this one's loud. Ooh. Yeah, this one, and this one needs to go down as well. There's another one, this one, wow, this. Yeah, so now it's just a little sniff in the background. I'll leave it open for your interpretation, you know, how you want to interpret that, but I will take, now I'll start to bend stuff around. You have to understand that the softer you space stuff out, the better it is if you're going to pan it out of the middle. So if you want something to be not as loud, but add something to the beat, pan it around, you know? It's a little bit too soft now, I don't hear it. Bam, nice one. All right, obviously there's 15 million things that I can actually still do with it. I mean, from this point on, you would usually just add your bass lines, add your different things, but that was not the case. case that I wanted to make today. I wanted to just like tell you like, okay, how would you that's a little swing. How would you utilize those little bits and bobs that are not necessarily stuff you need, you're grabbing for in the beginning? Everybody makes a lot of cool loops, makes a lot of cool beats, but how do you utilize these little things? I can go in a little bit more in depth on that stuff, but that means that this video is going to run for at least 3 days. That's not what we want, so I will leave it at this and jam it out. Cheers. Once more, I'd like to tell you that links to the equipment noted in the fold below. If there's something that you saw that you thought like, hey, that's interesting, how did he do that, where can I get those red knobs, what's that fly case all about, or hey, I like that Model D, but where can I get it? I've got affiliate links, you won't be breaking the bank, and basically what it is that, yeah, you'll help me buy a small percentage that goes to me. Another thing where you can support me is on patreon.com/analogkitchen. I'm actually in the process of building the mixer. I've heard the filter this week. Do you see my face? I'm happy. I mean, we were working with it. You know, Chris was working with it. Vinant and myself, we were just like contemplating, where do we want this stuff to go? How do we want this filter to sound? And it sounds absolutely yummy. Now, we've got the slope. That's cool. Now we're looking at the Q factor on how we're going to actually like give the filter a little bit more character. Now that mixer is a live mixer. I mean, I don't want to get really deep into it because I mean, most of you, if you follow this channel, know this already. There's a gap in between what a DAW-less live performer can do and what a DJ does and a studio. That's just, it's different. I want to be able to have perfect sound quality. I don't want to bring like a huge mixer. I mean, the better the mixer sounds, the bigger it is usually. And that's not what you want if you want to just be like on the move and performing, right? I mean, so that's a thing. Now, another thing is that I would like that mixer to be very hands-on as well. Because, I mean, I'm not Octave One, you know, I'm not Bicep, it's just me. So it means that I need my hands and my feet, I've got pedals maybe. Sometimes I use a foot pedal for a reverb. I will do a video on that in the near future. It's a neat trick. But in the end of the day, you would want that mixer to just like take a few tasks away from you so you can focus on the performance. So that is what we're actually building. And it's, well, it's early days. I mean, we're ordering parts, but the filter, it's done, man. So I'm happy. Obviously, it takes a bit of money to get that thing set up, and if you join up on Patreon, you are actually participating in this whole mixer project. And the fact that I've got Patreon connected to Discord now means that we're all talking about this stuff. And not only that, there's DIY people there, there's like modular people there, obviously, and then there's just synth design people there. It's just like synth enthusiasts. It's a small little corner of the web that I have claimed, where the kitchen is always welcoming other people to come in and sit at the table and enjoy the synth stew that we are serving. There you go. All right, so the music you can buy on Bandcamp. There's all links down in the description below if you want to find out what is what. So, I know I'm forgetting something, but you know what? I'll catch you next week on another video. Peace.